He gets it. There's a lot of political corrects and incorrect behavior going on back and forth here, whether we could be racist in the way we're targeting this one individual. I guess if you talk to my next guest, radio host Michael Smerkanish, get over the whole political correctness thing. He delves into that quite a bit in Muzzled, From T-Ball to Terrorism, True Stories That Should Be Fiction. And he's been patiently sitting by in all of these developments. Michael, good to see you.
Nice to see you, Neil. Thank you for having me.
It is apropos to what's going on today, though.
It's
isn't it?
Incredibly related. And I know Alice Hoagland fairly well, and her son, Mark Bingham, one of the great heroes of Flight 93. The reason that there was not a fifth terrorist on Flight 93, and arguably, and the 9/11 Commission came to this conclusion, arguably the reason that that plane did not reach the Capitol or the White House, its intended target, is because on August 4 of 2001, a month in advance of September 11, an INS agent at Orlando International Airport named Jose Melendez had a Saudi national come before him, Neil, and the guy, quote, just gave him the creeps. And the politically correct forces, pre-9/11, said to Jose Melendez, you know, these Saudis, they have a lot of political clout. You better go easy. Are you sure you want to reject this man? And Melendez did reject him. Well, that man, Mohammed al-Qahtani, was captured on a battlefield at Tora Bora. He's now at Guantanamo. He would have been the fifth terrorist. And why do I make that point?
Well, because that mission might have succeeded.
That mission might have succeeded. And I think that the lesson is that we can't be so politically correct, because these are no longer minor instances to our quality of life. Now, in a post-9/11 world, arguably, they threaten our ability to survive.
But think, Michael, that we should start then checking at the borders, that if you look Hispanic, if you look Arab, you don't come in?
I think at the border, everybody gets stopped. I think that there are different rules that need to apply
so
between
three
borders.
Swiss guys are coming through the Mexican border.
Are there paperwork? Is there paperwork in order? And by the way, I'm not afraid to say it, because I'm unmuzzled. The three Swiss guys are going to be deserving of less scrutiny than the three Saudis, because that's the reality of the world in which we live.
You know that the nation is hysterical right now about the potential of Arab or Muslim-looking types doing some harm to us, that maybe we drop our guard and don't look at the Swiss guys.
Neil, I wish the nation were hysterical. See, my
beef, you don't think we're hysterical?
No, my beef is that we're not hysterical. My beef is, you know, it's the story from our childhood, the emperor has no clothes. We're all walking around. Nobody wants to say it. Everyone's afraid to confront reality. And what I'm trying to say is it's time to speak up. Enough of you said it, pussyfooting around the issue.
Yeah. Let me ask you this very blunt question, but you're a blunt guy. Could it happen again?
That it could happen again. I think that we have failed to learn the hard reality, the lesson of September 11, and that is to recognize those who threaten us, because they're not the Swiss. They are members of radical Islam, and they still maintain commonalities, race, gender, religion, and yes, let's not be afraid to say it, appearance. And I think that we need to factor that into everything we do relative to the borders, relative to the airports, because...
Do you feel safe when you fly?
No, I don't feel safe when I fly. And I think to myself, if I'm not feeling safe here, then how could I possibly feel safe on the Canadian border or on the Mexican border?
So when they widened the standards, the TSA did, on things you could bring on planes, that just... raise more concerns. That we're
more
not.
Concerns and a lot of window dressing. I mean, yeah. I just don't think that there's any of the street smarts, Neil, that the Israelis are using. Take a flight on El Al and see what you think when you fly to Israel, as I have done and perhaps as you have done, because I'll tell you, I slept like a baby on that flight.
Since 9/11.
Would you screen the 80-year-old with the walker that Michael was referring to?
I sure would.
Really? Why?
I think there should be universal screening. I think
but if there are only so many people you can screen on a given flight, right? You can't take them all out of the line.
Right. Well, everyone's screened getting on the flights I'm on, and I think that's as it should be. And everybody is checked against watch lists, and I think that is as it should be. And if we start exempting the 80-year-old woman in the walker, I imagine that that'll be where Al-Qaeda tries to recruit people.
But I'm not advocating that we exempt her. What I'm saying is that if we're only going to be able, because of human resources, to have random screening of 16 or 17% of the passengers, let's not waste those resources on the 80-year-old woman with the aluminum walker, or the woman that I write about in my book who has quadruplets who are 2 months old. They have to unwrap the gauze, Neil, from the kids just so that they can be wanded. Are you kidding me? Quadruplets flying from Phoenix to Philadelphia? Give me a break.
Philadelphia.